friend.
Get there, there will be sky, and it will be beautiful.
Hey, I gotta set us free. They wanna kill us all in the morning, but I'm gonna fix it.
You could escape me!
Peter! We were right. The sky is beautiful, and it is forever. And I've been flying with our friends.
No!
Yes.
No! I'm not gonna lose him.
He's gone.
I'm not letting him go.
We are warriors. Warriors. Yeah. We are warriors.
Back in the cage.
You're a bad dog.
Do not say that to me.
Work. You're a bad dog.
Go, baby.
What did you do?
Take back what you said that I'm a bad dog.
Nope.
I know you don't really think I am a bad dog. Can you please take it back?
I will not.
Oh!
All right. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining. This is a webinar titled Creating Believable Character Animation in Maya. My name is Jordan. I work for Autodesk as a solutions engineer, and I'm very excited to be here along with all of you. In a moment, I'll hand it over to Nathan, who's from Framestore, and kick it over to Nathan. Nathan, you're up.
Thank you very much. Yeah, lovely to be here and to be able to present all this lovely work that I have to show you. So I'm here today to take you through, you know, how we really create believable character animation in Maya, looking specifically at Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3. And like Jordan said, my name is Nathan McConnel. I'm an animation supervisor at London Framestore. All right, so just before we dive into that, I'd love to show you a little bit about Framestore, our company. So we actually set up in 1986. You can see our original founders there. We've got Sharon Reed on the screen left, Jonathan Privett from left to right, Alison Turner, Mike McGee, and Sir William Sargent. Many of which are still at the company today. And we are a visual effects company, but actually we're more than that. So I'd love to show you a little video where you can kind of see a little bit about all the different types of work that we do.
Thank you.
All right, so just to take you through in a little bit more detail, you can see a timeline here of all the different shows and projects we've been part of. And really in the last 10 to 15 years, we've actually diversified from visual effects in film and advertising. And we now have things like the Framestore pre-visualization service, which also includes virtual production. We have a curated roster of directors, an art department, motion graphics as well. So we do virtual reality, augmented reality, real-time experimental projects, theme park rides as well. So it's not just visual effects within film and advertising, but so much more than that. So you can see like a little snapshot of our timeline there from 1986 all the way to most recently. And here is the coming soon projects we've been part of most recently. Some of these have already come out. Some of them are still in production. Hopefully you might have seen some of these or seen the trailers or things like that. So yeah, lots of lovely projects that we work on at Framestore. All right, so a little bit about myself. I actually really wanted to be a comic book artist when I was growing up. I used to love drawing all the time. And I really knew that art was going to be a big part of what I wanted to do without knowing necessarily what career I wanted to go into. So I studied fine art and psychology at university, and then I started getting into digital media and digital animation. And that's where I went to Bournemouth to study computer animation as a master's, and actually met a lot of like-minded people there as well, and people I still work with today, which is a lovely shared experience. So I actually began animating in 2002, and I've worked across Europe and America on around 30 shows, things like Dark Materials, which is a TV show, Alice in Wonderland, Fantastic Beasts, and then most recently Guardians of the Galaxy, which I'll be talking to you about in a sec. And I've spent about half of my career actually supervising, and also half of my career actually at Framestore as well. So I'm actually going to be in my next role going to Mumbai to help build the animation department over there. Okay, so I actually peaked in front of camera when I was 5 years old as a gangster pasty boy in 1984. And then I waited till I was an adult and worked on as a digital artist in commercials before going into CG features. And then I joined Framestore to work on things like Children of Men, Harry Potter, Golden Compass, things like that, before going to LA in Sony to work at Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs and Alice in Wonderland. Then I returned to London to work at Dean Egg on things like John Carter of Mars and Paul before returning to Framestore, which is where I've been for the last 8.5 years. And I can definitely confidently say that Framestore is my favorite place to work. I really, really enjoy here, the culture and everything. It's a great place to be, especially if you love animation. So here's some pictures then. So that's me as a five-year-old, as a gangster pasty boy. The middle one is for the Golden Compass 2007. And that's hopefully what I look like now on screen right. All right, so I'm here today to talk to you about really the work that we did on Guardians of the Galaxy. I hope everyone's watched that film and enjoyed it. And really, in terms of the character and creature development, you know, first of all, kudos to James Gunn for really having the confidence to actually build a story around a full CG character. You know, that's no sort of small undertaking, really, because you know, it's sort of a big deal with a big superhero tentpole movie to actually have the whole emotional center and cornerstone of it hinge around a full CG character is no small thing. So we really needed to make sure that we did that vision justice and did it proud. And also say, you know, kudos to James Gunn for actually writing in such a sort of strong element, quite a bleak element of this animal cruelty. You know, the fact is that Rocket and his friends are horrifically tortured throughout this film. And that's really his tragic backstory and why you see Rocket as an adult being so angry and cynical. And that animal cruelty thing is actually quite a bleak statement, but quite a profound one and sort of an emotional one to actually provoke a reaction from the audience, which I really hope we succeeded in doing that. So, first of all, you know, what a great show to work on as well. I really, really enjoyed it, and really bringing characters like Rocket and his friends to life is a massive sort of opportunity for our lovely talented animators that we have at Framestore. So we really did develop all the stages of Rocket from a runt, which is the smallest of the litter, all the way through to a baby, to an adolescent, and actually to an adult. The flashback sequences were mostly full CG. We also had different variants of Rocket as an adult as well. We also developed his friends. So Lila is an otter with robotic arms. Teeth a walrus. Flora is a rabbit. Cosmo is a talking, a dog that wears an astronaut suit. And Groot is a chunkier version of what we've seen in previous films. And I guess when you start thinking about the differences between bringing a character to life that's actually full CG compared to what you have on set with an actor, you know, if you have an actor portraying a character, that is one consistent character that they can sort of create through a whole film or series of films. Whereas for animation, you know, it's such a laborious and manual labor of love. You know, the time it takes to actually develop these characters and develop the animation, the performance, it takes a long time. So really, for Rocket, we might have 50 animators all contributing to his performance that you see on screen. And that's why it becomes really, really important that we keep consistent performances across all the different sequences and all our different sites, because we have more than one site working on this show. So lots of pressure on the animators, but they really did succeed on this film. And these are really just highlights of the sort of stuff that we did on the show, by the way. There's plenty more examples I could be showing you, but let's focus on these ones. So we also worked on a stampede with hundreds of animals, all animated by hand, and no small feat in itself either. Ultimately, it was up to the skill and experience of our hugely talented animation team to create these nuanced and stellar performances. And like I said, we absolutely loved working on the show. Client was very, very happy, and we even made the director cry in a good way. All right, so some stats for you. So I mentioned we have multiple sites working on the show. Across the company, we did 1,358 shots. London took the lead in terms of just under 800 shots, including the Christmas special, which is the Disney Plus Christmas special that came out. We did a lot of Rocket shots, some group shots, the interior shots with the cage when you see the flashbacks. Montreal did some lovely work with Cosmo and Groot and Rocket as well, and similarly with Vancouver. We had over 800 people credited, plus support staff that weren't, unfortunately. We also did, in about a year and a half, I think, over 230,000 versions of assets and shots. So a lot of versions that we submitted. And no surprises here, but the shot that we submitted the most amount of times was a stampede shot that we submitted 756 times. But production would like me to let you know that version 750 was actually the one approved. So we did six too many for that one. All right. And in terms of, our involvement with Maya, how we actually go about doing our work, well, first of all, you know, we use Maya for all the stages of animation, so from previs to post-viz, blocking, primary, final. We use it in all those instances, and we tend to show viewport play blasts as much as possible. It's much faster to iterate. We can send it later because we don't need to wait for renders. And we really try to get as close as we can with those viewport play blasts to review the work with us, you know, internally and with the client. And we will obviously have to switch at some point to show renders to make sure that everything else is working correctly, you know, with the motion blur and all that kind of stuff. We use many of the default tools within Maya, but as well, we have third-party ones, free ones sometimes as well that we just find that we find really useful. We have a great team at Framestore that build tools for us as well. So we have proprietary plugins. So in the case of that Stampede that I'll be showing you later, we actually use something called Choreographer, where we're able to switch our rigs to caches to make them a lot lighter to enable us to get that amount of animals into a shot at one time and still have it scrub. And all sorts of other things, you know, synoptic views where we're able to create a character picker where we can choose the character's face or the fingers to speed up our workflow. And we also have dynamic tools as well where we're able to add sort of, you know, dynamics for things like tails, possibly for ears, things that can help, you know, we can, if there's a way to do something faster and to leverage the computer in some way, we'll obviously try to do that to help us with some of that work. And dynamics for tails and things like that is a really useful component of that sort of tool. And outside of Maya, we also have other departments outside of animation, we have other departments that use Maya as well. So FPS, our Framestore pre-visualization service, rigging, tracking, layout, creature effects. So our pipeline really is built around Maya. It's the industry standard for us, and we dip in and out of it throughout our pipeline. All right, so I've got a little series of postcards here to show you. I won't dwell on these too long because I've got so many other things to show, but if you look at this top left image here, you can see an example of what a play blast image would look like direct out of Maya, and then how it relates to the render. The next one along, you can see a puppet that was being held by the Hayu Evolutionary. And you can see what we did to it as a render, putting Rocket in there. Many of these shots are actually full CG. Some have background, you know, a real plate to start with. And similarly and so forth here. So maybe have a look at this one, bottom right, you can see we've got a plate that we started with, and then what we've actually added in this instance is Rocket and the steering wheel as well. All right, so now we're getting into the nitty-gritty of it. So how do we really start? Well, for this show, we were actually provided some concept art from Marvel to actually get going on. We had an advantage on this film, I think, because just skip to the next slide here, you can see we know what Rocket needs to look like. We developed that from the first film already. And we know his character. Rocket's, almost got like a genius level intellect in terms of how he's got such dexterous fingers. He can create things. He's got a sly wit. But he also has this hunched over quality, this anger, and sort of a curved spine that keeps him kind of creaturey, but also, you know, in that sort of tension mode. Generally, he'll have an S shape to his tail and all that stuff. And the first thing to sort of really mention with these images that I'm showing you is that they're very much sort of a starting off point in terms of, you know, getting us going. So that first image there on left, this is Rocket Runt, so the smallest of the litter, essentially a real raccoon, a baby raccoon, but still has to retain a little bit of that Rocket identity with the texture, the look of his face. If we skip to the next image there, screen right, we can see this is his next iteration. So next stage of his development, he's been tortured now. So he's actually had his brain, some sort of brain surgery. He's now got opposable thumbs and dexterous fingers, and obviously a very painful existence to be put through. And then you can see him growing up now. He's bipedal. He's got these chest implants. But one thing, like I was mentioning, in terms of his pose, this isn't quite right. This doesn't really encapsulate Rocket's character, because he has that iconic sort of hunched over quality, which these don't have. Similarly, you know, the tail feels like it's connected to the spine, not connected to the spine, which it really should feel like it's an extension of that spine. Perhaps the hips are too wide there. So there's things there that we know we need to sort of validate and make sense. So we want to take this 2D design and actually turn it into a functional 3D one for a process of validation, where we would typically start modeling, start working out where these pivot points are for the anatomy, how this anatomy fits in there. We'll always be building the bones within the geometry, by the way, because that's a really great place to start. And then we need to try and do a series of motion tests, a series of performance tests to make sure the proportions are actually working for what the character is. So I've got an example to show you here of where we ended up. So we went through this process of iterationing, and really the assets might take, you know, 6 months to actually get from beginning to end in terms of where we're starting, and when we finish, we call it approved. But you can see here, we've got our little baby run. So the smallest of the litter, quite frail and light. And then we've kept the next one quadrupedal as well, even though he has those human hands. And then at this point, he's bipedal, but he still retains that quality that you see. Hopefully, as you see them as a cohesive whole, they have similarities that you can see there. And if you were to see them from the side, Rocket's actually getting less and less hunched as he evolves, as he gets older. Okay, so we'd essentially be doing a series of walks and runs like this. We would show this to the client. Multiple advantages for doing this, because we can make sure the assets are approved, we can make sure the character's right, and we can show this to the client, make sure they agree, they're happy with the direction it's going. And then we can also, as our team gets bigger, we can show this to the new members of the team, and they can, you know, get a sense of what we're aiming for with these characters. So we have an advantage when we're working on the previs and the posts, and we're into these shows so early. We can actually then start cherry picking little moments from the sequences to work on. So here's an example of what we do after we've done those sort of walks and runs. We'd actually cherry pick a shot which might be useful for us to develop. And this is one just after he's had his brain surgery and all that stuff. He's been chucked into this cage environment, and he meets these strangers. So he's obviously in pain. He's trembling because he's not sure of his surroundings. And we were really trying to make sure we got that emotion clear. And this is where we ended up with that test, which James Gunn really liked. And here's another one. A little test here with the little babies doing the run, sort of fighting over each other. And James Gunn liked these little tests so much, they ended up using them on social media to promote the film. Okay, so, and this is a really good example of a play blast, actually, that we would have straight out of Maya. But another little test where you can see really Rocket sort of, it encapsulates his sort of journey, really, because he is very much on a journey of being wide-eyed and innocent to cynical and angry, because he's just escaped from the high evolutionary who's killed his friends. Okay, so a little journey there in terms of how we would sort of develop these performances. And as we're doing this, we're working, I mentioned, with some previs and posters as well. Here's an example of a frame of previs. So you'll notice that the design, the assets are a little bit cruder. There's less detail there. But what they do have is great storytelling. They have framing. They have enough information there to be able to be put into an edit, be put into a sequence, to be shown to the director, to be shown to an audience, where we can actually get feedback on how the film is all sitting together. And really, this is the moment where, you know, the team is a little bit smaller, they're iterating, they're faster in terms of making changes, they're expecting all these changes. If we can make the bulk of our changes in a movie at this point, then we're absolutely laughing, because, as I was mentioning earlier, animation is an intensive process that can take a long time. Once we get into the animation properly, it might take us a couple of weeks to do a couple of seconds worth of animation. And if we've got the wrong shot or the wrong idea at that point, we've wasted that time and everyone else's time, and time is money. So, you know, the more changes we can make in previs and posters, the better. All right, then this is an example of our a play blast when we're into animation. So these are all through Maya as well, I should mention. We're now adding more detail to the look of Rocket. So he's got proprietary fur there. We've got a fur plugin we're able to use, which sits on top of what we have in default Maya. And we're able to get a bit more detail out of the asset itself. Similarly with the background, and similarly the animation itself would be much more nuanced and detailed as well. And then here's an example of that rendered. So this is when, after animation, we've taken it through creature effects, we take it through lighting, all those other departments, compositing, and we've got that realistic photoreal quality with the defocus and that lovely lighting, all those extra bits which make it really feel believable. Okay, and this is a really good example of where it's useful for us to see renders as well. So if I show you, like, here's our render, here's our play blast that we see. The first thing that you notice, or you might notice, is that Tiefs and Lila here, you can barely see them at this point because of the defocus. It's very blurred. There's such strong lighting, it's really highlighting Rocket's face. So that really tells us we need to be paying attention as much as we can to those details that you're really going to be highlighting with the lighting. That's where it becomes very useful. And just as an aside, if you ever watch the film again or see some of our reels that we'll be showing you, you might notice Rocket builds this key card. And he actually does that because, you know, using his supreme intellect. But we looked at reference of Rubik's Cubes, Speedmasters, that people that are just so have that dexterous, frenetic energy to actually build things really, you know, change things really quickly, almost faster than how they can think about it. It's like a tactile memory. That was something that we thought was quite reminiscent of the way that Rocket reacts with and works with objects like that. Okay, and here's an example of a puppet used on set. So we would typically, you know, we built our assets in 3D. Those assets we can pass back to the client. They can build these puppets, and we've got the right proportions, hopefully, that match, so that they can use these puppets on set. Lots of advantages of that for that, in that, you know, the high evolutionary here, he can actually physically hold that puppet on set. He can look at the character as well. Similarly for the cameraman, he can frame on Rocket and get the depth of field correct. Although when I look at that, I think it looks a little bit blurry, but that's an aside. And here's what we did with it. So we're able to put Rocket in that same position. Obviously, he's moving, he's got a performance that he's delivering. So it's not going to match that puppet exactly, but we have the right sort of framing. We know that he's going to be centrally framed in that shot. Okay, so in terms of reference, first of all our animators have such strong understanding and demonstration of the principles of animation. They don't need reference to create believable performances. But when we do have reference, we can obviously choose how we use it and how to take the most appealing parts of it to make the most appealing end result. The animators also shoot their own reference as well, if needed. So really, you know, when we did have reference, we would obviously try to use it to take the salient parts out of it. For Rocket, we would be looking at raccoon reference and real raccoon animals. But also we have actors on set. And in fact, as well as James Gunn, a great actor in his own right, you'll see in some of the reels that he did actually really enjoy dancing as Groot in the end of the film our lovely team in Montreal did. So he's not afraid to put on his acting skills as well. But actually for Rocket on set, we actually had Sean Gunn, who is James Gunn's brother, and, you know, a great actor as well. Really useful for, you know, we really getting the spirit of what James Gunn is looking for in that sort of on-set photography when it was available, because you get the framing, you get the kind of camera movement he's looking for, you get that feeling of interaction. What you don't get is obviously the fact that Rocket is much, much smaller. So Rocket is his own character. He's not, you couldn't look at any particular reference from anywhere and say that is Rocket. It's very much a curated combination of lots of different things, because he is his own character. You know, as much as we have lovely face performances from the actors, at the end of the day, he has a muzzle, he has ears, he has a tail. You can use the tail and the ears as a device to add emotion, you know, to really emote. So as an example, if he's really happy and alert and excited, we can have those ears really, really perky. If he's sad, we can drop them down. If he's tense, we can pull them, you know, so there's a tightness to them. Similarly with the tail, we can have that sag if he's feeling a little bit sad. Okay, so there's devices we can use that are in addition to a human. His size being smaller, he's lighter, he's more lithe, and also he can go into quadrupedal performances quite quickly as well, which, you know, you can't tend to do as a human actor. And then we also had Bradley Cooper's audio performance. Typically, he's actually reading from a lectern, a little bit like what I'm doing now. I'm standing, I'm looking down and talking. Bradley Cooper would be sort of really trying to channel all his emotion through his voice. But we still have that as reference that we can use to make sure we get the right timing and all that stuff. And really what tends to happen, as I'll show you in a minute, is that sometimes through that process, we can actually have a few problems, a few bumps along the way. Now, here's an example of where that did actually happen to us. So we got into primary, which is where we wanted to start getting into the face performance. And we blocked this whole sequence out with a certain intention in mind. When we got Bradley Cooper's performance, he was so emotional that he actually covered his face with his hands and muffled his voice, which meant that we really needed to do that as well, because there's no other way to achieve that sort of sound. And first of all, we're thinking, well, can we actually cover Rocket's muzzle with his paw? And I think it just about worked, which is great. But then we had to figure out throughout the sequence, then how is that hand removed? And we end up using Lila to gently and gracefully pull it away from his face. But those sort of changes can actually have big impacts for us, because at that point we're into the sort of finaling and trying to finish the shots, and then having to re-find the performance can be a bit tricky for us. But on this show, that was one very rare example of where it didn't go all our way. But really, as I said before, James Gunn, what a great director, really knows his stuff. Really was so clear and direct in terms of what he was hoping to achieve, made a lot of the bulk of the changes in the previous and post stage, which is perfect situation for us. That's what we want to do. All right, so hopefully that gives you a little bit of a taster of how we would develop a character like Rocket. In terms of his friends, we would then take that idea and use that same process, really. So in the case of Lila, the otter with the robotic arms, Tiefs in the walrus in the wheelchair, the astronaut dog, and Floor there with the rabbit with the spider legs, as well as Groot not pictured here. Those are the concepts. I'll just show you some postcards here of before and after. So you can kind of see, this is our Maya play blast of Tiefs. He is a walrus, so we were looking at walruses from zoos. We found some lovely reference of a walrus sitting up, and you can see all this weight of the neck and the torso really sort of, you know, under gravity sort of pulling down, and this lovely floppiness to the flippers. That's what we really sort of gleaned from that reference we tried to put into Tiefs. And, you know, he also has these horrible devices around his eyes, which means that he can't blink. His eyes are permanently open, a bit like Clockwork Orange or something, where, you know, it's quite a painful looking implant there. That, you know, there's no reference for that particularly. We just, you know, we glean from what we can. And if you look at this image here of the actual render, you'll notice again that the lighting's coming from screen right. So that really tells us, you know, we want to make sure this reads this screen right eye particularly, to make sure this shot is reading effectively to an audience. And then similarly and so forth. So for floor, you know, first of all, we're looking at spider reference for the legs. We're also looking at rabbits for posing of her body. She actually has limp front legs and also limp ears. And she also has this bane-like mask on. So really she's emoting really mainly through her eyes. And she also has these lovely antenna, which we're able to sort of use as a device to emote. So we had a lovely scene one of our animators did where he actually had them sort of tremble and stagger to create that anxiety that she was feeling at the time. And here's an example of what that looks like rendered. All right, and then this is a really nice, again, encapsulation of, you can see the reference that we have here on the top right, compared to the previs, compared to the final animation. You know, we really try to keep the spirit of what we see, what they've done on set for this tag scene, this particular sequence. Again, Lila is her own character. We're looking at Otter reference. There's a lovely slinkiness to her spine that we really thought was important to kind of give her that otter-like performance. And she actually has quite short legs and long feet, which means that she can't, you know, have the same foot pattern that the actress has. She has to do her own thing. We have to respect the anatomy and the character that we're aiming to achieve with her. And again, we've got a lovely floppiness on Teef's flippers as well. So we hopefully kept the spirit of the performance, but it feels natural to these characters. All right, and then for Cosmo, a slightly different proposition, because the rest of the characters we just talked about are all anthropomorphic. So they have human-like tendencies. They talk, for example, whereas Cosmo really doesn't. She is actually based on a real dog. So our first protocol was to see whether we could actually match a real dog. And hopefully you'll agree with me that I think we did a lovely job on that one to make it feel believable. And then the next step was really to do a performance test, again, a vignette of some sort, so cherry picking a shot in this case. And really the process was, you know, how do we get a similar sort of performance from Cosmo that we see with the actress on the set? We noticed, we realized really quickly that it's very difficult to, the more you push this into an anthropomorphic human performance, the more cartoony it feels. There's no anatomy in Cosmo's body that actually tells you that she's a human. She's actually talking through these speakers. She is really a dog that is just actually doing dog-like things with these speakers. So we realized that very early on, the process we went through is then looking for reference of a real dog. Didn't have to be the same breed of dog, but just something that had that similar sort of contrast and expression and similar feeling of that head turn. That there's an attitude there, which I think was a lovely test that the guys in Montreal did, and it worked really, really well. All right, so the stampede. I was mentioning hundreds of animals, all animated by hand. A very similar sort of process in terms of, we'll start with run cycles and all that stuff. We've got a lovely library at Framestore that we're able to leverage as well. Building all these creatures up, putting them into these shots. We have a path tool that we're able to actually stick them onto as well to create, you know, the right trajectory. We'll build up these sort of configurations and kind of performances with that. And using Choreographer, where we're able to switch from rigs to caches to make that a lot lighter in our scenes. And then we also threw some obelisks in there and all that stuff. So you can imagine for not just for animation, but for everyone after animation as well, and before, every department, what a massive challenge this sequence was, and what an expensive challenge as well, because, you know, it's a big, big sequence to try to put together with that amount of characters. There's so much work in there. But really, James Gunn felt so passionate about this, because when you think of the cathartic release and the journey that Rocket goes on, that undertone of animal cruelty, this is the cathartic release of that. This is the moment where all that pain and that anguish that Rocket's been through, he's able to release and free these animals to avoid what's happened to him, happened to these creatures. So it's a really important sequence for the movie, and a really important sequence for James Gunn as well. So what a lovely job that the team did on that one. All right, I've also got a pre-viz visualization reel to show you next. So you can kind of see the viz versus the renders and all the rest of it, how it ended up.
It's okay. You're here with us now.
It's a new guy. You've got, like, a mask on your face.
Mask, eyes, face.
It's okay, friend. Don't let them scare you. Good to have friends.
You thought you could escape me? No! You think you have some worth in and of yourself without me? No!
No!
Rocket Raccoon.
My beloved Raccoon, this story has been yours all along. You just didn't know it.
So I've also got some other breakdowns to show you from other departments, just because it's not all about animation. And this is an example of the very first sequence in the movie where Rocket actually morphs from littlest runt to an adult. So not only was the animation obviously a challenge there to help that process happen, but also, if you can imagine the amount of detail that the groom needs to have and how to morph the groom to work with two different assets, as well as the geometry. That was obviously a big challenge for our team. Here's some comp, different layers that go into putting the rocket into the High Evolutionary's hand. We also developed animated and angry turtle transformation that gets incinerated. You can see the layers that went into that. As I was saying, many of our interior cage shots were full CG, so we needed to build that in 3D and make sure that it felt photo real. It looks beautiful as well. And then it also needs to cut with live action, you know, seamlessly as well. So that's all the stuff we did, as well as some face replacements for the high evolutionary when his face is removed. Quite a gruesome moment there. We did some augmentation to the set, you know, extensions. For Nebula, when she reveals to the rest of the Guardians that Rocket was actually his torture, his experience was worse than what Thanos did to her. That's the moment we did there as well. We built the recorder in 3D, showing off that headpiece. And these were the layers that went into compositing and rendering all this, the white corridor where Rocket sees Lila again after she's dead, as well as his friends. We haven't talked a huge amount about the other characters, but Mantis Antenna, you know, we animated those. Again, we got some environment extension work that happened here. We haven't talked a huge amount about Groot, but it's worth talking about him. We animated all his bark pieces. You know, we can animate that to give him weight. We can animate his chest bark. Also, if he puts his foot down on the ground, he doesn't really have feet, but his stumps, we actually spread the weight out by spreading that bark pieces there. And also, you know, we had an on-set actor, but you notice that Groot is so much bigger and heavier. We need to really just respect the size of him. So we need to give him that weight that he required there. All right, so hopefully everything I've shown you, I mean, it's a lot to kind of pack into a short show and tell there, but here's a summary where you can see a little reel now in terms of all that lovely work that we did. And hopefully it'll make a lot more sense.
Raccoon.
Friends are gonna go flying together into the forever and beautiful sky.
They wanna kill us all in the morning, but I'm gonna fix it.
Shall be Teeth's, because although we all do have them, mine are definitely the most prominent.
Meat be called Floor, because meat is lying on floor.
It really is good to have friends.
Yeah.
Telekinesis is cheating!
You're a bad dog.
Do not say that to me. Take back what you said, that I'm a bad dog.
Nope.
I know you don't really think I am a bad dog. Can you please take it back?
I will not.
Amazing. Thank you so much for sharing, Nathan. We got a lot of really great questions, so I'm going to apologize ahead of time that we're not going to get through all of them, but I will do my best to summarize the themes that I saw.
Okay.
Let's just jump right into it. Nathan, is there a standout character or moment in this film that reinvigorated your love for animation, or maybe one on the flip side that, you know, was a little bit stubborn to get done to the final stage? Both of those experiences?
No, I think especially on this show, it just, you know, I wasn't lying when I said it just went so well in terms of, I think when you have such a great script and you have such a great director who really understands animation, and he's very clear in terms of the direction that he wants to go in, you know, he's writing the stuff. And I think as well, because he uses music so intelligently, when he's building his sequences, he really looks for the right music to work with the emotional content of that scene. So the example maybe at the beginning of the film where he's using Radiohead's Creep, that mm-hmm. seems to be really a good sound that sort of encapsulates Rocket's sort of feeling of himself and he was relating to it. And once he kind of really irons that out and gets that music there, the sequences just really flow, and you can just feel that sequences work really well. So our animation and our job was really very much just to do that justice and make sure that the character and that, you know, we provoke that emotional reaction in the audience that we have. So in terms of standout things, I mean, there's just so many to choose there that really pull at your heartstrings. I couldn't really single out anything at all, but certainly no particular stubborn shots on this movie at all. I think we just really, like I said, we had a few stumbling moments where, in that example I gave you, where Bradley Cooper's audio performance, he got so emotional that it was different. You know, that was a setback in terms of, you know, it takes us longer to finish that sequence, but it's better for it because we got that, you know, that tangible sort of sense of dilemma that Rocket's really experiencing. He feels guilty, all these sort of emotions that are going through his mind. So yeah, just a really fun project to be part of. And that's really rewarding in itself because, you know, I've worked on films in the past where you work just as hard as we worked on this one, but they're not such well-received films, or they don't seem to fit together as nicely. And you know, it's slightly sad because the amount of work and effort you put into it is the same, but it doesn't hold together that well. So what a lovely show to be part of, and I'm so glad it's been well received and it's doing well, and we made lots of people cry in good ways as well.
Multiple times, thank you for that. Yeah. That actually segues perfectly into my next question about getting hired and moving into feature film industry. What advice could you give for folks that are starting out, haven't had that feature film experience, but want to work in that direction, maybe in a general sense and specific to Framestore? Is there certain stuff that they're looking for in reels, and what's that process?
Well, first of all, I think, you know, as a student, we're looking for potential. So people that are able to show the potential to learn and develop, you know, we'll obviously be bringing people in to train, and they'll be learning on the job as well as the onboarding that we do at Framestore. But we're really looking for that spark, that flair, and really, you know, the principles of animation, how to tell a story, those things are so important. It's one thing to kind of understand them. It's another thing to actually then demonstrate it on your showreel. Okay, so we're really looking for people that have that sort of sense of potential, understand the medium. It is very much a craft. Everyone's learning. I'm continuing to learn. You never stop learning. There's so much more you can learn. And if you think you know it all, you've probably forgotten it, or you haven't worked on a particular type of project or show, that you just constantly have to keep learning and trying. And that passion, that has to be there. You know, you have to be somebody that's a very proactive, passionate person about this work to do it, because we're looking specifically at Framestore at a very high level of quality. We're aiming for that high bar, bespoke, handcrafted feel as best we can. In terms of showreels, you know, I just say it's so important to show your best work. If you show us something that, you know, let's say, for example, your first shot, your last shot, make those as strong as you can. And really think about the order that you put those shots into your reel. If you're including something because you know it's not very good, well, really question yourself why, because, you know, that's what we do. When we look at someone's reel and we go, well, look, this guy's got some really nice work on their reel, but why do they put that shot in there? Is that because they don't know that it's not as good as the other ones? Or, you know, what's your thinking? And that could be really hard. It's really hard to be self-critical. Show it to your friends, show it to your peers, your colleagues, and they'll give you hopefully some honest advice as well. But you have to be really, really harsh. It's a really good lesson, you know, and we've all been there. When you start, it's very hard to get your foot in the door at the beginning. You want to show the amount of work that you have, but you have to be honest with yourself and think, well, look, what is my best work? You know, if it's short, doesn't matter. Just see your best work possible. And I think that will hopefully be enough to sort of get your foot in the door and continue your journey within it. We're really looking for that potential, as I said. All right, so really pay attention to that, guys, because I think that's a really important one. I think it's all that online information is out there, but actually people that actually respond to that, you'd be surprised how often that is kind of ignored, actually.
It's harder. It's that same emotional component that went into this film. Like, these are our babies that we're putting out into the world.
So. It really is, yeah. But, you know, and the beautiful thing about it as well is when you bring somebody in that's a bit raw and has that potential, and then you just see how they develop at our company, it's just a really, really nice feeling that you're going, oh, they really understand what they're doing. They really have that passion for it. And then they're succeeding in doing it as well. We have some lovely projects at Frame. So there's, and every animator and, you know, everyone in the team, they're so willing to share their knowledge as well. You know, it is very much a shared experience. It's a collaborative experience. You know, there's so many people that go into making these films. And, you know, like I said, there's over 800 people credited on this one. There's a lot of people and a lot of wealth of talent and experience that people are willing to share their experience and knowledge.
Yeah, awesome. Again, perfect segue. The learning component that you mentioned and the development that someone has at Framestore is great. How about folks that are outside of it? Do you have a list or, you know, your favorite resources to go to for learning? I mean, University of YouTube's great, but if you have favorites, then
I really liked Rishi Williams, the animation toolkit. I think that one's just really, really excellent. Yeah. And there's MyBridge books. There's I think it's Walt Stanchfield that has those notes that when he was at Disney, you know, how to create shape and volume by, you know, static poses versus having a bit of depth to them. All those things are just so useful to absorb and to soak up and then try and actually demonstrate. I think that's the most important thing for me. Just really, you know, that there's so much information you can take in. Life is quite an important thing. I remember, well, I can't remember where I was last week. I saw this guy running down the street and I thought he almost looked like a Looney Tune run. He was sort of had a headband on and he stuck his head out and quite a, you know, strong up and down. And you put that into the bank and you remember that for the next time you might need it, because all those people you experience, you know, you see, and you'll be able to glean from that useful reference that you can use in a character or a film at a later date.
Yeah, and then you have to convince someone that came from real life too.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, in terms of working in Maya, do you use tools that are not native to Maya? Can you recommend some for folks that are looking into getting into groom processes? That was a big topic in terms of questions, is how do we
get into what processes?
Using hair and groom and getting that sort of workflow nailed down in Maya as newbies.
I mean, you know, we have a very specific department that deals with that. I think XGen, the sort of stuff that we have within Maya, we've definitely used that for sort of viz type purposes. But then when we get into things for film more specifically, we have a lot of our proprietary tools that we tend to lean on. So things we've actually built within our company to work that's exclusive to us. In terms of sort of generic sort of tools, you know, there's plenty of things for animation that we use, things like, you know, anim tools, animbots are a really popular one. And I really like Red 9 suite of tools. They're free actually as well, those ones. But there's plenty of free online tools just generally that you really, I think the problem can be is the more that you try out, you've really got to try and make sure it works for your workflow, because, you know, I work in a certain way where I'm used to that workflow. And for me to sort of start changing it too much now, you know, I'd be slower than just the way that I'm able to do it with my workflow. And similarly, people that have learned sort of, you know, more recently that are able to use all these different tools that are newer, you know, that workflow is going to work better for you because you're just familiar with them. But it's really about understanding that these tools exist and being able to use them when you need to get yourself out of situations. So yeah, but in terms of grooming, that's not my area of expertise to be able to talk about that too much. You'd have to speak to another of our amazing team that we have. But yeah, I think that we tend to use our proprietary plugins and stuff. Like I was mentioning with the choreographer thing, where we're able to switch our rigs to caches as being a really, really invaluable one when you're working with crowds and all that sort of stuff. So we really try to make ourselves as efficient as we can by using the tools that are available. And if they're online and they're free, that's a great place to start. There's plenty of them out there.
Yeah, bring them in. And Nathan, I'd actually love your perspective on this too. The nature of software is that it's always evolving. Powerhouses like Framestore have to stay on top of that stuff. So what resources do you use and to stay on top of that movement? It's quick.
Yeah, I think, you know, we're always looking at whatever's new and really trying to embrace it when we can. I think the other thing that's really important to be aware of is equally, because we have such a robust and established pipeline, is also incredibly difficult then, depending on what it is, to add it in a way that sort of makes it easily accessible. So it will take us, you know, through necessity a little bit longer necessary to sort of absorb new technology. But I think we're always trying to do that all the time. And if it's a specific tool or plugin, a lot easier to do than if it's something a little bit bigger that then means that we have to, you know, fundamentally change the core of our pipeline. But, you know, newer departments, you know, our Framestore pre-visualization service, for example, they're coming at it at a much different approach because, you know, their requirements are different to what we have in animation and film, where, you know, it's a volume thing where we have to be passing things through a particular way to each department. Mm-hmm. And other departments which are freer to explore that. So, for example, our art department, you know, they're able to use lots and lots of different things to be able to, whatever it is, they're able to get that end result. Do you know what I mean? So you're able to use whatever's out there right now, and there's really nothing stopping you. So, you know, we're obviously trying to take on all the things that are happening throughout, but we will be on a slightly older version of Maya. And we have to sort of take longer to adopt it because we need to make sure all our tools work with it as well. Actually, that's the other thing, that things are constantly changing, like you say. But for me, I always remember, it doesn't seem to matter what show you work on. Let's say with Rocket, for example, we rebuild Rocket for every new film that we do with him. You might think, oh, we can just use the old rig and use it that way. But no, we need to, you know, because our rigging tools, our modules, everything's evolved and got better. Our technology is constantly improving. So we'll always constantly be reconfiguring and rebuilding in that sense as well. So it never stops. But yeah, in terms of tools specifically, I mean, I think USD, I think, is probably the biggest one that we're trying to adopt at this point. I think that's the future as I understand it. And then obviously looking into sort of a little bit in AI, I know that sort of, you know, what that can do for us. I think where I've seen it successfully be used is actually to pull out green screens through a sequence for us. So when we're trying to sort of quickly put together play blasts to show the client a sequence, we've got a rough version where we can actually put the CG environment in with some sort of plate without too much sort of handheld quality stuff coming from some of those departments. So it's creeping in a little bit, but yeah, it'll definitely, you know, inevitably take us a little bit longer to adopt because we need to make sure it works with everything else that mm-hmm. we're doing.
Yeah, and you mentioned AI. We had quite a few questions come in about that.
Okay, yeah.
Did you use AI for any of your workflows? Will you use AI? Should animators be scared about their jobs? Can you give us your take on that movement in the industry?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of buzz around it and a lot of, you know, press. And I can certainly see, you know, to my mind, it's a tool like anything else. I don't think it replaces, you know, you can say the same thing about computers when people have lots of skill and lots of talent, a computer comes in and suddenly it's changed the way that you work. But really, it'll always need someone to, you know, animation particularly is a craft where I think people want to be able to lean on people's experience and skill and be guided through the process. And AI, I think, you know, I haven't seen anything yet which has made, you know, there's no animate button. Sometimes we wish there was, to be honest. But no, I've not seen that. I mean, there's, like I say, lots of things. We had, you know, we've been looking into sort of machine learning, tracking of faces. We haven't talked about faces too much, but we do a lot of things with fact shapes. And there's all sorts of things we've been trying to use for a long time, actually, and different companies as well, where you try to get the computer to solve that face track. And, you know, it sounds great. And I'm sure a lot of companies will be saying, this is what we use. But the reality is, unless the fundamental jaw performance is perfect, everything you put on top of that isn't going to work. So it's a very much a, you know, it's one of those that if it does work, it the quality we're going for is 100%, I suppose, the highest quality we can get. If you're looking at more of an independent show or something that's a little bit lower budget, something where it's just good enough, maybe that there's applications there. But for what we're trying to do, we're very much at that top end to the point where, for the most part, the way that Framestore is, we're very much a handcraft studio. We would build everything using the people skills that we have. And I think the way that we build our faces and all the rest of it would be no exception. There's other shows that we've worked on where you might think it would work really well for that sort of process to actually be able to use AI or use some sort of machine learning. But at the end of the day, it always comes down to the animators to try and say, you know, make it work as effectively as they can. So I don't think, you know, I'm not worried in that sense, but I think, you know, it's a tool to be utilized by people that understand how to use it, I would say. But yeah, in terms of what we did on Guardians, in terms of animation, we have things like I mentioned, dynamics tools. So if we wanted to have some performance to the tail, a little bit of overlap, we can sometimes use a Maya hair follicle with some sort of joints on it to give us that overlap. We also use something called weight shift, which is a little bit more complex, but gives us some nice dynamics and things like that to help speed us up. But in terms of AI, for animation. No, we're not using anything like that at all. It's a bit, I guess the argument is equally valid for like motion capture. Why don't you use motion capture on this sort of stuff? Rocket isn't the motion captured animal. You know, you can't motion capture him. Like I said, he is his own character. He's much smaller than a human. He's quite creature-like, and there's no, it wouldn't work in that context. It'd be a different movie if it was made in that way.
Yeah, totally agree. Yeah, so don't panic about AI yet, right? Like that's the takeaway.
No, I don't think so.
On the theme of tools, can you tell us what tools you use to create the fur in this production, as well as your render engine? That's a very hot topic in the Q&A.
The fur, well, look, I think we have proprietary stuff specific to Framestore. So in terms of lighting rendering, we use our own system. It's called Freak. And then our the fur that you saw in the play blast there is like a proxy version of what our rendered fur would look like. I was mentioning, I think it was yesterday, wasn't it? The XGen, we sometimes use that for, you know, for sort of viz type purposes. But when we get into the film side and we're doing it for that film quality, we're using our own systems really.
Okay. Same for the rendering engine too.
Yeah. So Freak, I think, is our sort of the way that we, I think it was developed on Gravity, and through PR Man Gravity, they sort of started pretty much just building their own version of it. And it's not my area of expertise at all, but I understand that that's the way that we do it.
And if you have artists in house that are advocating for a new tool to help artists work faster, does that start with the department, like the animators, if they needed something, and then it trickles its way up, or does it go the reverse direction?
It can be a variety of sources, but we actually have a tech anim team that are really good sort of conduit between R&D and pipeline as well as animation. So they are constantly helping us to develop and make our workflows more efficient. And it could be just as simple as creating GUIs for us or whatever it is. It could be utilizing tools that are free online that we're just adding to our shelf, or we're really sort of identifying an area that we really need something, and they would try and make something fit that, you know, particular thing. So, you know, we have all sorts of things from character pickers. You know, we're able now to use animation layers to go down the pipeline. We have pipeline constraints, which are able to exist beyond, you know, because we spend a lot of time rebuilding shots actually. And we want to be able to rebuild in a way where you don't lose work. And we have tools there that we can sort of rebuild with, but still keeping constraints and layers, all sorts of things that we have. But really the crucial thing is, you know, if you can save 5-10% worth of you know, be more efficient mm-hmm. by spending a bit of time creating a tool to do it, it's a no-brainer to do it that way. So yeah, we definitely have a proactive sort of team that help us with that type of problem and that type of work. But we're always asking for more.
Yeah, of course. I'm sure that's a tough job with new versions coming out too. They have to be cognizant of code compatibility and needs.
Like you say, it's constantly evolving, and that means that we have to keeping up with it. And yeah, I think they're in the process of rewriting some tools from, you know, I wrote all my tools in Mel. Oh, the dinosaur, and people are now getting all sorts of Python things that
amazing. Well, after all of that, this can probably seem like an intimidating industry, so do you have courses that you would recommend new artists get started with, specifically in animation? And we have Coursera, Animation Mentor, any of that
stuff? Any of those. I think in terms of, you know, learning, there's so much material online, I think, anyway, to be honest. There's so much stuff out there, even lots of free stuff, to be honest. And, you know, I think the people that, obviously, going and doing a course, I mean, for my route personally, I went, as I said in my talk there, I went down to Bournemouth and did a master's, where I met a lot of like-minded people, and that really helped me personally, because I could sort of look over my shoulder and see what they were doing. That would, you know, you learn by osmosis really in that sense. So it's lovely to be on that journey with other people together, but equally I know plenty of people that have just, you know, they got really interested in it and just, you know, self-learning, that never stops, such an important part of it anyway, that that there's so much information out there to sort of push you forward. But I think the thing that I think we always look for is that core skill and that core sort of talent, that sort of flair and that sort of engagement with the work that you're doing. It's not just enough to be able to move things around. You need to know why and how and what the purpose of it is. Have an intention. You've got to be thinking about, is your head leading the action? If your head's leading, then that means your chest's going to follow. That means your shoulder's going to follow. Really think about it. And when we look at work, sometimes you ask that question, what's leading there? What's your intention? And sometimes animators, they don't know. And you think, well, why not? You need to know that those, if you don't know, you're not going to be able to then portray that in the animation. So it's very much a kind of process of getting your mindset and your critical eye actually sort of working in the right way. And that's something you develop by practice, actually. So just practicing, life drawing, life experience, all those things come into play. And there's many different journeys for people from all different disciplines. I came from one route, but there's people that come from 2D animation backgrounds, the people that come from more scientific backgrounds. Really what galvanizes us and makes us a cohesive group is that we all have that passion for it. And it doesn't feel like a real job to us. It's just fun. It's great to be part of projects like this and presentations like this, where we're able to show what we're able to do. And give us a voice, actually, because very often if we've done our job correctly, you won't notice it's been done. You know what I mean? When you see Rocket Oakley, you don't think of all that work and all those people that have gone into that. You just think of him as a character on screen going through that journey. So that's the ultimate sort of thing for us, really.
Yeah, that is the hardest thing, describing what animation is to non-animators. Like, there's not just a walk button. There's not just character can tell what to do, and to make it look effortless, like you said, is a real, real beautiful challenge to get through.
Absolutely. I remember when I was just sort of first starting out, it was such a challenge for me to be able to create a walk cycle, to learn how to loop things and make sure it actually technically was doing what it should be doing, how to copy the animation from one side to the other. And I was working so hard just to actually make it loop and be a cycle that I didn't really have any opportunity to even think about what's the performance. Just making sure it was walking. And but then as you get more comfortable and you understand the technique and all that stuff, then you can have those sorts of thoughts and those sorts of intentions with the performance, because you know what you're in control of it. That's, I guess, what we're also looking for, people that understand how to manipulate the medium that we're in.
Absolutely. Nathan, thank you so much for your time and your expertise and your behind the scenes looks at stuff. We had so much fun with you. Thank you, everyone, for attending. Yeah, we'll see you all next time.
Take care. All right. Bye-bye. Bye.